be happening right now.
Uh-huh.
So there's our recording. So I'm going to go ahead and open up the meeting now since we are recording it. And I'm going to mute you all. So that is... Okay. So again, you can turn off your videos if you would like. And I am going to spotlight myself. And I am, it looks like I'm sharing my spotlight with Ron, but that's okay because he's going to be presenting. But I did want to let you know a little bit about what you're about to see. So Susan Simon, most of you know this, she has produced this. It's a topic near and dear to her heart, as Ron will explain. And it is directed by Ron Field. So the two of them have really come together in a very wonderful way over the past few months. Susan has really climbed a very tall ladder of learning how to use this technology and working with Ron so that the presentations that they can do together collaboratively are just so informative. And I know that all of you who have been here before for their previous presentations know how great they are. Ron will be our formal presenter tonight. And of course, this is being brought to you by Gotalindi Dance Studios. If you don't know, I am Gotalindi Dance Studios along with Chester. So here's my little Chester. Linda and Chester Freeman. And every third Friday, we are doing a Zoom presentation. We will continue doing these presentations indefinitely because they've been so well received and well attended and informative, and we're really enjoying them. But we are slowly opening up, so you can now check our website for things that are going on. We will be also holding our first dance in an outdoor dance on July 10th. We've just made that announcement. And so if you're interested in that, check that out on our website, gotalindi.com. And we have some classes coming up. So we are moving into beyond the screen. So having said that, I'm going to turn this all over to Ron. And I am trying to figure out how to get rid of myself from the spotlight. There we go. There we go, Ron. It's all yours. Except that you're muted, Ron.
Of course, I could do all this by sign language, but besides that, yes, as the slide showed, I'll be narrating all of this, but don't expect Susan to be silent. I never do. So, Susan, feel free to sing out anytime you like. A few 1920s female blues singers and why they were so blue. You know, we could focus on the blues for a year and not be complete. I mean, we could do this, forever, just various aspects of the blues. Many forms of the blues, from country blues, urban blues, Delta blues, English blues, blues all over the place. Consider the blues to be the tree trunk around which the vines of the other musical forms wind. Jazz, country, pop, rhythm and blues, funk, etc., etc., all are influenced by the blues. And why are we doing this now? Well, we're honoring music pride, dance pride, and gay pride. And by the way, happy Juneteenth. June is Gay Pride Month, and one way to honor this fact is to focus on one aspect of the blues phenomenon. Gay Black female performers in the 20s and 30s in New York. Now that's awfully specific, okay? Tonight we focus on just the tip of the iceberg to pique your knowledge and curiosity. Feel free to dig deeper on your own. Big Three of the Blues. Now why do we call them the Big Three? Let's go back to the days of acoustic recording before 25. Anyone, particularly a female singer, who really wanted to perform had to be big. Imagine a little slip of a woman, very short, of stature, her voice wouldn't reach past the fourth row. In order to belt it out to the cheap seats, you had to be big. Okay, the quote unquote fat lady, when she sang, everybody heard her. Her voice had to reverberate off the walls. Otherwise, she didn't exist as far as the audience is concerned. So if you're wondering why many of these blues singers are large of stature, that's, you know, basically the reason. These are the people that we're going to be featuring in this presentation. There are many others, and as I stated, it would take forever to focus on all of them. Mamie Smith, Ma Rainey, Mamie Smith, Ma Rainey, Bessie Smith, Gladys Bentley, and last but not least, Memphis Minnie. The names under the main names are singers, present day singers, who will be characterizing the people that we'll be focusing on. So you'll see them singing the way Mamie Smith, Ma Rainey, et cetera, sang back in the 20s later on in the presentation. What we want you to do is listen not only to the lyrics to hear what these female blues singers are singing about, but we want you to feel the intensity of the emotion in the voice to know not only what they're singing, but why they're singing. Mamie Smith and her Jazz Hounds, Crazy Blues, recorded August 10th, 1920 on OK Records. OK Records, as we'll see, was a very important black label back then. And this was the very, very first blues hit. I should mention now that one of the very first recordings, if not the first recording of a blues song, was W.C. Handy's St. Louis Blues, composed in
1914. Before... I can't sleep at night. I can't eat a bite. He makes me feel so blue.
Okay, Susan, if you keep that slide up, what I want you to do is note the instruments. This would be very, very typical of a jazz band back in the 20s and even before, with one exception. Note the clarinet, the trombone, the trumpet, the piano. Also note the violin. Very few jazz bands had a violin, although some did. The only thing that may be missing would be a tuba, later replaced by a bass fiddle or a double bass. Also, what I want you to note, not only with her, but other blues singers that we'll be focusing on, note what she's singing about, her man, and how that makes her, and how her man treats her, makes her blue. That's important, and it's very typical of the subject matter that female blues singers used in their performances. And now, a modern rendition of the very same song.
I can't sleep at night. I can't eat a bite. 'Cause the man I love, he don't treat me right. He makes me feel so blue. Sometimes I sat and sighed, and then began to cry. He went away, never said goodbye. Well, I can read his letters, but I sure can't read his mind. Thought he was loving me, he's leaving all the time.
Very good. Again, note how the style hasn't changed in 100 years. That's kind of what I meant by saying that the blue is the tree around how other music forms, kind of form. Ma Rainey, mother of the blues. This be an empty world without the blues. She bridged earlier vaudeville and the authentic expression of Southern blues, influencing a whole generation of blues singers. In other words, she made blues popular. Once again, I want you to note the instruments. Again, we have the trombone, the trumpet, a couple of trombones actually, and the drums, even though you probably won't hear those drums in this recording since it was made before 1925. But again, this would be typical of a jazz band that would play both jazz and blues. Also, I want you to, listen to what this blues singer is singing about.
So damn funny.
Okay, if that song sounds familiar, it was recorded by any number of people. Lloyd Price, you know, did it in the 50s and 60s. There were various blues groups, some of them English, that recorded it in the 60s and even in the 70s. Believe it or not, it was based on a real incident. Stagger Lee, or Stackle Lee, as the song, you know, portrayed it, was really a real person who did shoot Billy Lyons on Christmas Day in 1895. I won't dwell on that, but he became a subject of, you know, folk history and folk heroism, you know, back in the day. Ma Rainey was married to Pa Rainey, no surprise there, but had numerous affairs with women, many of who were female jazz and blues singers of the Harlem Renaissance. In 1925, she was arrested in her house for having a lesbian party. Her protege, Bessie Smith, bails her out of jail the following morning. They were both part of an extensive circle of lesbian and bisexual African-American women in Harlem. After her arrest, she records "Prove It on Me Blues."
When I last night had a terrific fight, everything seemed to go wrong. I looked up to my surprise, the girl I met was gone. Where she went, I don't know. I mean to follow everywhere she goes. Folks said I'm crooked, I didn't know where she took it. I want the whole world to know. There must be women, cause I don't like no men. It's true, I wear color and a tie. Make the wind go all the while. But the way I do it, ain't nobody called me. They sure got to prove it on me. Oh,
That's Ma Rainey with her Tub Jug Washboard Band. I think I need to explain that. Back in the South, with people that probably couldn't afford instruments, they made them up. They could play almost anything. A tub referred to a wash tub, an overturned wash tub with a hole in the center through which a string was pulled. String was tied to a stick, which was placed on the back of the tub and plucked as if it were a bass fiddle. If you moved your hand up and down the string, plucked it, you got various bass notes out of basically a washboard, a stick, and a string. A jug was just that, a jug over which air was blown to also simulate a bass sound, which might depend on how much air you blew over the open end of the jug and how much liquid was in the jug. I'm thinking the liquid was probably not water. The washboard was exactly that. You took a washboard, hung it around your neck, and strummed it up and down, again, to simulate the rhythm of whatever music you were playing. Jug bands proliferated, and they still do. There are jug bands still around, playing music, a bit more sophisticated, but they're considered jug bands. And what you see is an example of the washboard on the left. In the center, you do see, that wash tub bass and so on and so forth. So this I would consider to be a poor man's orchestra if you couldn't afford real instruments. And now a modern day, a depiction of the exact same song that you heard from Ma Rainey. And this comes from the movie Ma Rainey's Black Bottom Blues, okay? That came out last year.
A one, a two, a you know what to do. Be an empty world without the blues. I try to take that emptiness and fill it up with something. But they want to call me Mother Blues. That's all right with me. It don't hurt none.
Way down south, and
where's the horn player?
Come on, Libby. You rehearse like everybody else.
I'm gonna get me a band and make me some records. I knows how to play real music, not this jug band shit.
You call that playing music?
I know what I'm doing. Go on and fire me. I don't care.
When I got there, they began to say,
that's to get the people's attention. That's when you and Slow Drag come in with the rhythm part. Me and Cutler play on the break.
Levy, the sooner you understand it and what you say, it's what Ma said to count.
We'll be ready to go in 15 minutes.
We'll be ready to go, and Madam says we're ready to go, and that's the way it go around here.
These records are gonna be hits.
Please come home to me.
Every colored man in the world got to do his part. I'm gonna tell the white man just what he can do.
They don't care nothing about me. All they want is my voice.
About them songs I give you.
They're not the right songs. I don't take them off your hands for you.
I got
got my time coming to me.
Hey! You don't know nothing about what kind of blood I got, what kind of heart I got beat here. Come on. Come on!
Just a cursory depiction of what you'll see if you go to see that movie. I would consider that a very good depiction of, you know, Ma Rainey. Bessie Smith, the Empress of the Blues. I don't want no drummer. I set the tempo. She was the most popular female blues singer of the 1920s and 30s. She is often regarded as one of the greatest singers of her era and was a major influence on other jazz singers. In my opinion, she's the best blues singer I ever heard.
Bessie Smith is the greatest female blues singer who's ever lived.
Born in Chattanooga, Tennessee, in 1894, Bessie Smith hit the theater circuit at the age of 18, touring in minstrel shows and cabarets. She started her career as a dancer on the same bill with legendary singer Ma Rainey.
Ma Rainey was always known as the ugliest woman in show business, and Bessie was not. Bessie was known as being beautiful.
Bessie segued from dancing to singing, and her talents drew large audiences. So she created her own show.
Bessie Smith's shows were often extravagant. She had as many as 40 people in the cast.
Bessie's show traveled the country, and in many areas of America, segregation was the norm.
In some places, there were black rooming houses, theatrical rooming houses, where they stayed. So when Bessie Smith had her own railroad car, that became their home away from home, and they cooked there and they slept there.
Bessie's success was enormous for the time, and she was pulling in the unheard-of sum of $2,000 a week.
Just the whole idea that Bessie Smith and Ma Rainey were able to make a living at that time. These women were writing their stories, singing them, and making their own money, and they were emancipated women to me. They were the first feminists.
Bessie understood the hard-drinking, promiscuous, and violent life she sang about in the blues because she lived it.
At the end of the songs, you always got this sense that despite all this, that this was a woman who was going to overcome it, and she did.
By the early 1920s, Columbia Records discovered her, and she became the best-selling blues artist of her time, making almost 160 recordings, including tunes like Backwater Blues and Tain't Nobody's Business If I Do.
She had a good business mind. She would sell the records in the aisle. She also sold other merchandise. The Bessie Smith Show was a traveling marketplace.
When I discovered Bessie Smith, I was like, oh, that's where Janis got her stuff. That's where Mick Jagger, Robert Plant, everybody's been listening to Bessie Smith.
Smith's rich life was cut short by a car crash at the age of 43. Thousands turned out to mourn her, but she lay in an anonymous plot until rock legend and fan Janis Joplin bought her a headstone several decades later.
She had a swagger. She had a incredible booming voice.
Rock and roll is rhythm and blues, and it came from the blues of Bessie Smith.
What you'll see now is the only film recording of Bessie Smith and her blues.
My man's got a heart like a rocket in the sea. My man's got a heart like a rocket sea. My man's got a heart like a rocket in the sea. My man's got a heart like a rocket in the
I defy anybody to listen to that and not feel the intensity. And now, a modern day movie depiction of Bessie Smith's blues in the movie Bessie, 2015.
Remember what I told you about the blues? If you're not risking nothing, neither will they. What's your name, pretty lady?
Bessie Smith.
Down in Atlanta, GA. Under the viaduct every
day. With the good music, the good food, and the good liquor.
Drinking liquor and howling hooray.
She most demonstrate syncopate, electrifying woman in the world.
Ain't nobody doing it like I'm doing.
They want to record you, sis, to the Black Swan label. Woo!
Yours in negritude.
What the heck is negritude?
You been by Mama's grave yet? I guess you think you something.
We do not feel that you're a fit for Black Swan Records.
It's about damn time she start taking advice from a Negro that don't wear no stage makeup.
You better turn your damper down.
I ain't playing second to nobody anymore.
You promised me, Jack.
You promised me too.
You're trying to kill me.
Tears falling on the ground.
The blues is not about people knowing you. It's about you knowing people.
It's a long road, but I'm gonna find the end.
Gladys Bentley, the living embodiment of Hark Harlem in the 1920s. Pre-war gay life flourished in urban centers such as New York's Greenwich Village and Harlem during the Harlem Renaissance of the 1920s. The blues music of African-American women showcased varieties of lesbian desire, struggle, and humor. These performances, along with male and female drag stars, introduced a gay underworld to straight patrons during Prohibition's defiance of race and sex codes in speakeasy clubs. In my opinion, this woman, Gladys Bentley, was outrageous.
I'll make you miserable to treat us women like you do. I'll make you miserable, treat us women like you do. I don't want no man that I got to give my money to. Call me a leather, never nothing but a no. Call me a leather, never nothing but a no. Go right back and told him, man, I ain't no silly goat. Ba-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Give my man everything from a diamond ring on down. Give my man everything from a diamond ring on down. Ba-da-da-da-da-da-da. Next thing I'm gonna give him 6 feet in the cold, cold ground. Ba-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. You can never tell what an old, old man can do. Ooh, la, da, 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 da. Never tell what an old, old man can do. Ooh, la, da, 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 da. Keep your eyes open, girl, cause he'll put that thing on you. Da, 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 da. Cause you ain't even got a papa. Ain't no single that you can't be at. Da, 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 da.
Gladys Bentley was a pioneer in pushing the envelope of gender, sexuality, class, and race with parody and exaggeration, personality, and professionality. She was one of the most well-known and financially successful Black women in the United States in the 1920s and 30s. And I hear an excerpt from a PBS documentary aired last year.
Bentley sometimes was billed as a male impersonator, showing queerness and flirting with women on stage and singing songs with lyrics that are upsetting all the cultural norms about identity.
That's a gorilla, a woman killer, and I ought to know.
Bentley's lyrics were known for their bold content, highlighting her cross-dressing tendencies and her feelings towards women.
She was not the only person who cross-dressed. Ethel Waters did it. Marlena Dietrich did it.
Here go
women, in their own ways, were challenging conceptions of what a woman could be. Gladys Bentley represents this lyrical and sexual prowess that women like me can wear on stage that is not ladylike.
Stage is gonna lean, so fresh, so clean. For them boys, the skirts, the butch, bald, and jeans.
My name is Charlotte Ammons.
Freak, freak, convene. Sit like Charlotte, perfect, connect, like.
I am a musician, writer, and television producer.
I need to lose some sleep. I need the struggle, resistance, and the comic relief.
Just knowing that Gladys existed and existed so proudly and so openly changed my life and completely gave me license to be all the things that I am. Black, Southern, queer, an artist. And so I started writing this record called Twilight for Gladys Bentley to reimagine Gladys in the body of a hip-hop artist.
Gladys, today I'm wearing armor in honor of my father. Tomorrow overalls for my aunts, my mama.
Gladys used the popular music of her time to make a statement. I used the popular music of my time to make a parallel statement.
In 1928, Bentley began a recording career that would span two decades. She traveled to clubs all over the country and inspired characters in several books.
The clubs where I worked overflowed with celebrities. I had made my mark in show business.
But beyond the world of show business, Bentley's lifestyle faced criticism.
There was really no way that someone like her could be viewed as a respectable figure at this time. This is the Jim Crow era, right? There's such a concern about racial uplift, upward mobility, that a figure such as Bentley is seen as so deviant that many in the mainstream African-American community were not a fan, to put it mildly.
There were people such as Adam Clayton Powell or traditional mainline churches that had views of homosexuality that did not fit the tenets of Christian beliefs. And for many people, it was an aberration, something going against what God dictated. And so that backlash existed.
Bentley's act fell on hard times in the mid-1930s.
The Depression definitely made a difference in the entertainment world. And with the end of Prohibition, we actually see more regulation of nightclub spaces. There's a concern about bar spaces that are seen as disorderly, and disorderly was often a code word for gay at this time.
In 1937, Bentley moved to Los Angeles, California. But there she faced challenges to her desire to perform on stage in men's clothing.
The state of California actually had anti-cross-dressing laws that went back to the 19th century to keep entertainment good and clean. And there were times where she was banned from performing because of her cross-dressing.
In the early 1950s, Bentley adapted her public image to match the times.
The post-World War II era becomes incredibly conservative, especially around norms of gender and sexuality. And this leads to what is known as not only the Red Scare, but also the Lavender Scare. And this kind of comes to a head with the firing of hundreds of government employees who are thought to be gay.
And possibly as a reaction to those times, she had to change her performance style to stay employed and to keep doing her line of work.
This is when we see her publish an article in Ebony magazine with the title, I Am a Woman Again.
For many years, I inhabited that half-shadow, no-man's land which exists between the boundaries of the two sexes. Today, I am a woman again, through the miracle of modern medicine, living a normal existence.
In that same article, Bentley stated that she consulted a doctor to receive hormone treatments and also married a man.
I think she's spinning a tale of respectability, right? A tale of someone who wants to be seen as fully human in this very repressive time.
If you read that article really closely, it really is a plea for tolerance and understanding. She's not condemning who she was or is, but really explaining the struggles of what it meant to live her life. She went back into the closet,
so that one day I would never have to do that.
Pacifist might laugh at this, might ask me if I'm a masochist, giving.
But this is a white boy's game still. When you're making music that represents a marginalized history and the gatekeepers still don't look like you, that's something that a lot of musicians and artists who are Black or queer are constantly battling.
Bentley was studying to become an ordained Christian minister when she died of complications from a flu virus at age 52.
I see her as a pioneer. She's somebody we could all look up to, whether we're gay, lesbian, bi, heterosexual. She invited us to be our whole selves. And that's what we all want to be.
Red beans and rice, greasy bacon in the pot.
I have earned the distinction of being the first, and in some cases, the only performer of my race to crash the most plush glitter spots. I am still a star.
Who can blame that woman for singing the blues? She had a lot to sing about, and she did.
I'll make you miserable, treat us women like you do. I'll make you miserable, treat us women like you do. I don't want no man that I got to give my money to. Call me a leather, never nothing but a no. Call me a leather, give her nothing but a note. Go right back and told him, man, I ain't no billy goat. Give my man everything from a diamond ring on down. Give my man everything from a diamond ring on down. Next thing I'm gonna give him 6 feet in the cold. Cold ground. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da. You can never tell what an old, old man can do. Da-da-da-da-da-da. Never tell what an old, old man can do. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Keep your eyes open, girl, cause he'll put that thing on you. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Cause you ain't even got a papa. Ain't no single that you can't be at. Cause you even got a papa. Ain't no signal that you can't be had. If I put this thing on you, baby, gonna be just too doggone there. Mighty hard for you women to keep a real good man nowadays. Mighty hard for you women to keep a real good man nowadays. And these little young chippy gals got so many doggone different ways. Ain't no one did more for you than the good Lord ever thought. Did more for you than the good Lord ever done. Put clothes on your back. You know darn well you wasn't born right now.
I'm glad that video is there because it named many of the female blues singers of the era that we just didn't have time to focus on at all. Also, I hope you noticed that many of those records were on the OK label, probably the biggest Black label in the 20s and 30s and even the 40s. They not only recorded blues, but they recorded an awful lot of jazz records, etc. It wasn't the only Black label that did so, but it was perhaps the largest. Okay. And last but not least, Memphis Minnie, Queen of Country Blues. It's been said that Memphis Minnie played guitar like a man. Though she inspired as many men as women, her influence was particularly strong on female musicians. Her disciples included her niece, Laverne Baker, a rock and rhythm and blues pioneer in her own right, as well as Maria Muldaur, who released a 2012 tribute CD. Bonnie Raitt, who paid for her headstone. Rory Black, Tracy Nelson, Sapphire, and virtually every other guitar-slinging woman since. Keep in mind, she was a guitar blues singer at a time when there weren't many female blues singers who played the guitar. Most of the ones that did were men. Men like Robert Johnson, Muddy Waters, John Lee Hooker, etc. She used the guitar as her instrument as well as her voice. As I said, she was one of the few who used an instrument, particularly the guitar. That was a man's instrument, but she was exceptional. Well, what can I say? Move over, Blind Lemon Jefferson, B.B. King, Muddy Waters, Eric Clapton. This woman did it a long time ago, and she was the only female, or one of the few females, who was capable of doing it. Hey, Memphis Minnie.
To be my chauffeur,
That was Tuba Skinny, in case you haven't recognized them. And they do play locally. You might have noticed that they were playing in Rhinebeck in that particular performance. We put this in to illustrate the fact that, unlike jazz and other forms of music, the blues is least likely to change much in form from its original roots. This is how blues probably sounded more than 100 years ago. Not a lot of difference. And yet played by white musicians who all look like they were born after 1980, okay? You might have noticed the washboard player, et cetera. So it's a bit of a jug band. But again, this is a popular band who plays the blues the way it was played pretty much back in the day, way back in the day. That's all we have for you this evening. Our little corner of the blues and what we've come up with in terms of research. We want you to feel free to dive into the sea of blues. As I said at the outset, we've barely touched the tip of the iceberg. There is much more, even in, female, lesbian blues in the 1920s and 30s, there is more to see, more to hear, more to read about. But other forms of the blues, if you're interested in the blues at all, see what you come up with your research, and we hope you do, look into it. I believe we now have time for questions, comments. I'll be more than happy to give you my opinions on anything you've seen, or even some of the things you may not have seen that relate to what we've been talking about. We thank you for your participation in listening and watching and just being here. We really appreciate it. Now, your questions and comments.
So the way that we're going to do this, thank you so much, Susan and Ron. A lot of research went into that, very obviously, and we appreciate that so much. And I can't think of a better presentation to celebrate both Juneteenth and June Pride. So thank you very much. So the way we're going to do this is, if you're shy, you can put a question in the chat or a comment. If you're not shy, you can unmute yourself and just belt it out like the blues.
Please do, and I'll give you my best made up answer, which will be my opinion.
So any questions, comments, observations that you'd like to make?
And until you do that, I want to thank, Susan Simon for putting this together. I'm the talking head. I've got the easy part. All I do is get to, make comments on what I see. Susan is responsible for putting an awful lot of this together. And Linda, is responsible for prodding us and, making comments here and there to make this, what it is. So I'm the front man. I get the credit. I get to disperse the credit to where it really belongs.
Yeah. So questions, comments, observations, things you didn't know, things you realized. Aaron, are you, I saw your mouth move, so yeah. Just jumping on you.
I actually didn't realize that my mouth moved, but I suppose I do have a question. The one thing that stuck out to me about both of the biopics from HBO that we saw segments from is that it always seems to be the case that when the performer is approaching the microphone for the first time, they're already possessed of a kind of preternatural confidence in their own abilities. Like the actor portraying Ma Rainey was standing there just embodying some kind of archetypal form of blues woman confidence. And also there was a, sort of swaying back and forth and looking like she just knew what she was going to do as soon as she opened her mouth. And then on top of that, there's the band conflict amplification component of how these narratives about performers from generations past related to each other. So I'm not sure who the other musician, male musician in the striped zoot suit was supposed to be in that trailer, but it seemed like they were setting it up so that there was going to be some kind of deep-seated conflict between them. And it struck me that just always seems to be the case in terms of how narratives about performers from the past are portrayed, that they always know what they're doing, like as soon as they start, and there always has to be some kind of conflict between them and someone else because it's a movie. And how accurate do you think that is? And do you think it's regrettable in some ways that always has to be the way the story is related in order to try to draw the viewers in? I can see a way in which, like, at the level of accuracy and also just at the level of like feeling like you're watching something authentic, this can have some regrettable effects. So what are your thoughts on that?
I'll give you my thoughts on that. I'll give you my opinion. What you're looking at is the performer who's really performing their art. And the person you're talking about is probably the manager, the money person. And there's almost always a conflict between the two. Keep in mind, the manager, the money person, the person who's getting a percentage of the gate, wants the performer to perform all the time, as often as possible. The more performances you have, the more money is made. The performer, on the other hand, may or may not want to do that. Not only that, the manager may have a false sense of what needs to be performed. The performer has a very real sense of what they need to perform and how to do it. So very often there is a conflict between the creative person and the financial person. And again, I'm a little, I'm kind of boiling it down a little bit. I'm kind of oversimplifying it. But, you know, what you saw in the movie is not that uncommon. Almost every performer has a person behind them who is more concerned with the money than anything else. I'll give you an unrelated example. Irving Mills, you probably never heard of him, but he was a Duke Ellington's performer, and Irving Mills' name is on every one of Duke Ellington's recordings. Irving Mills never wrote a single note of music, yet he got a percentage of everything Duke Ellington did. And that is not, you know, all that unusual. So again, what you saw is, again, I wasn't there, okay, but what you saw is probably close to being accurate. Aside from the fact that, yeah, I think I see what you're getting at. The conflict between person A and person B makes for good cinema. Okay, you have to have that drama in there somewhere. Otherwise, all you have is a movie that's showing performances. You know, you have a concert. But I think a lot of it is, you know, true to life. That's my opinion. Anyone else?
And I'm gonna remove the spotlight from Ron so that we can go back to a gallery view and everybody can see each other. So if you'd like to, you'll still be able to see Ron. He'll still be highlighted in yellow. But if you'd like to return to putting your video on so we can see you once again. And again, any questions, just unmute yourselves. Any comments, just unmute yourselves. And we can join each other once again. So we're getting some comments, Ron, on the chat. What a great presentation. Thank you.
Thank you. Some
gratitude comments in there, which are always appreciated. Yes. And everybody's starting to come back.
Yes, I can see most of you now.
Yes, Yes. Well, that's why I like to start and end in gallery view so we can all see each other again, because I think that's an important part of it. So I thought it was interesting to see and experience both the original recordings and visuals of the singers, as well as the modern interpretations of them, which of course, you know, the sound quality is always so much better just because they're modern. But I thought it was a good depiction to see both of those.
Yeah, what I liked about those is that what you heard was the same song, you know, the same performance, you know, maybe 80 years apart. And the not just the difference between the two, but the lack of difference. It's kind of what I meant in my last comment about the blues really not changing much. It's still done the way it was always done. A little style difference. And hopefully you saw that in those movie clips.
Ron, I don't know if you could answer this. I have a sense of what the answer might be if you don't know fully. And that is the recording technique back in those days.
Yeah, I kept mentioning that before 1925, you know, things were different and certain instruments were, you know, played but not heard on the recording. Acoustic recording did not require electricity. What you had was a horn, very much like a megaphone. And the vibrations of the instruments, including the human voice, went into the megaphone through a filament and down to a shellac disc, okay, where those vibrations were recorded or etched into that shellac disc so that when you put a needle on that disc and, you know, churned up a Victrola, basically you kind of reversed the process and you would hear, you know, the recording through a another megaphone or horn. Again, it was not electronic at all, no electricity whatsoever, but you did hear the music. In 1925, that all changed with electronic recording. Now you have an actual microphone, which will take the sounds that are produced in the studio and change them into electrical impulses, which would be transferred onto the disc. Okay, and that's the difference. And what you would hear is a marked difference in the quality of the sound. But again, the original sound was basically just vibrations etched on a hard shellac disc. Okay, and those vibrations, again, were duplicated when you actually used a needle on a Victrola to replay it at exactly 78 RPM. I don't know if anybody has ever seen a Victrola, okay? But basically it has a little wind-up motor that you kind of wind up to the point where it actually turns the turntable at 78. Eventually it winds down and you gotta wind it up again so that it, you know, that 78 RPM happens. But that's how, you know, recordings were made. And again, certain instruments, just you didn't hear drums, you know, a lot of these recordings had wood blocks or other percussion, you know, type objects that could be heard. In one recording that we showed you, there was a violin. I don't know what that was doing there. I think he actually did hear the violin in the, you know, in the recording, but that was, you know, rather unusual. So listening to those recordings would not be like being there actually listening. The modern recordings with the electronic microphones after 1925 and the techniques they use today are, you know, I don't even understand. I mean, they're so electronic and computer generated and so on and so forth. It's almost better than the, you know, being there in person to hear it. But hopefully that answers your question, Linda.
Yes, and I'm so glad that you had such a thorough answer, because my answer would not have been that thorough at all. I think the game we should play next is let's try to stump Ron. So let's try to find a question that Ron doesn't know the answer to.
Oh, I know the answer. Which you don't know, I'm making this up as I go along. But no, I actually, a lot of the stuff that I've read parenthetically mentioned some of the, you know, some of the opinions that come out of my mouth. I mean, I, you know, seem to be able to draw upon these when I need to and so on and so forth. But yeah, I did quite a lot of reading on stuff that included what I just said. So it,
I think Chester had a comment.
Yeah, I have a let's stump Ron question.
Go for it.
When earlier when you were showing the illustrations of the jug band, the jug bands.
Yes.
And one of the instruments was the washtub bass. Have you ever noticed that every time you see a jug band and there's a washtub bass, that the washtub bass player always has his foot on top of the tub?
No, I haven't.
Why?
Probably to dampen the sound. One thing, the only other thing you can do to vary the sound is move your hand up and down the string against the stick that holds the string into the bass. Once you put your foot or anything on the bass, it changes the sound, you know, quite a bit. So if you go back to that second picture, he's got his foot on the bass. Now, he may be just resting it there. That's what it looks like. But if he actually put his foot on the part that the string goes through, okay, it does change the sound. It's kind of like, you know, playing a bongo, and you ever see a bongo player put his other hand on the drum while the other hand beats the drum, it changes the sound. That's right. What he's doing.
There's actually a more practical reason.
Go for it.
So I may have stumped you.
You may have.
There's a more practical reason. It has to do with the way they alter the pitch in the string. Yes, they're running their fingers up and down, but they're also pulling the stick so that they're making the string taut, more and more taut, to raise the pitch, because their hand is basically stuck in one spot. They can't run up and down the stick like a real bass player. They have to keep the hand there. So in order to get more notes, they have to pull the stick to get the string more taut to raise the pitch. And if you keep doing that, you'll tump over your washtub. So you have to keep your foot on it to keep from tumping it over.
Okay, I gave you my answer and your answer. I guess you stumped me.
I know this from bitter personal experience. Somebody put me on the washtub bass once to play, and I had to play the washtub bass, and I had to keep my foot on it to keep from tumping it over while I was pulling on the stick.
Makes perfect sense.
You do remember he's from Louisiana, right?
It is true. And I thought of you when I was doing my notes, and I wrote down about the washboard, because I know that that's used an awful lot in Cajun bands in Louisiana.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely. Good. Any other questions to stump Ron?
Feel free. It's easy to do.
Or comments or observations or queries or... I know I'm going to go and watch. I never actually saw the Bessie movie. I saw the Ma Rainey movie, but I never saw the Bessie movie. So I'm going to have to check that out. Although I don't have HBO. So I don't know. Somebody who has HBO is going to have to give me their password.
Question.
Yes, Bonnie.
Well, I watched the HBO Bessie movie years ago, and it was really, really good. In it, however, they depicted early on that Bessie and Ma Rainey were rivals and they weren't friends in the beginning. So, but later you showed that they were in fact lovers. Maybe that happened later on. Is that true, that originally they were rivals?
I can only think so. Keep in mind, Ma Rainey preceded Bessie Smith. In fact, Ma Rainey was her mentor. And I think I may have read, and I could be wrong, that in the very early years, you know, Ma Rainey may have been a little jealous of Bessie, the new upcomer, which, you know, wouldn't be that unusual. I can't verify that. I honestly don't know. I seem to remember reading something like that. But I do know that, you know, eventually Ma Rainey, you know, did mentor Bessie and, you know, gave her everything she could in order, you know, to succeed. Beyond that, I don't know.
Okay.
Aaron?
When Ma Rainey turned against her, what we would now call kind of prototypical trans identity, and made the declaration that she was a woman again, what motivated that? Was it financial, career, social pressure, or perhaps a religious conversion? It seemed like there could have been multiple factors at play there.
Yeah, it was. I think you're talking about Gladys Bentley, not Ma Rainey.
Sorry, that's what I meant.
I think it had a lot to do with the fact that at this point in time, her outlandish, you know, cross-dressing, et cetera, was really doing her a lot of harm monetarily, which probably led to a lot of harm, you know, mentally, sociologically, et cetera. And she may have, you know, seen the remedy to that, to going more mainstream and being a woman again. Keep in mind, even in Harlem, where, you know, homosexuality was not exactly celebrated, but it was tolerated, you know, if not accepted. Against Gladys Bentley, she was so outlandish. I think one of my comments was, you know, this woman was outrageous. She threw it in your face, you know, with her cross-dressing and her open lifestyle, et cetera, et cetera. So I think that she was kind of a magnet for a lot of the vitriol that, you know, people had to throw at her. So, you know, she had to bend, you know, in order to actually just make a living, you know, and so on and so forth. So it's my guess that that's why she, quote unquote, you know, became a woman again. I think the films that we showed just said that, you know, she was really vilified. Even in Harlem, she just couldn't perform, which is why she went to California, you know. And it was really hard to be vilified in Harlem, because like I said, during the Renaissance, you know, Harlem kind of tolerated homosexuality as long as you weren't outlandish about it, as long as you weren't too overt. In fact, there were people that came to Harlem just for the, you know, the gay lifestyle, the gay performances, et cetera, et cetera. You know, there weren't any crowds, you know, wanting to lynch you or anything like that if you put on a gay show in Harlem. But for Gladys Bentley, like I said, she was so over the top. You know, even Adam Clayton Powell came out against her and, you know, that sort of thing. So those comments answer your question.
Okay, so it's almost the magic hour that we do need to end. So unless anybody has any more burning questions or comments, there's a lot of gratitude happening in the chat. So thank you very much, Ron and Susan, for your hard work and your great presentation.
Our pleasure.
If you aren't already on our email list, you can subscribe at gottolindy.com. And always know what we are up to, and we're going to be getting up to more and more as time goes. So thank you all, everybody, for coming.
Thank you. Thank you all.
Bye, everyone.